Today, hey, it's a good day to be a Patriot, and it's especially a good day to be here in Chapel because we have a special guest. Hey, please stand. This first song is This Is Amazing Grace. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in all in wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Part of our campus here today. so we're excited. He and his wife, Sue, this is Dr. Mike Evans. Dr. Evans, would you stand up for me? He's going to be preaching at this. Yeah. Some of you passed his classes and some of you didn't. So anyway, we're excited that you're here today, Dr. Evans, and Sue's back here in the back. We're excited to be able just to hear God's word come from a man, God, that we truly know that God's got his hand on. We appreciate his teaching, his spirit of faithfulness to the Lord, and all that God has done in his life. And he and his wife, beautiful wife, have actually really retired. I guess that's the right word, isn't it? Really, really retired. So anyway, we're excited to have him here, and we're excited to do something next that we don't normally get to do, worship. I asked Sue if she had, if Dr. Mike had, a really favorite song. And this is his favorite song, Mansion Over the Hilltop.
Stand and sing this with me. I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransom will shine, I want a gold one, that silver light.
I want a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never go. And someday wonder, we will never know what. My pillow was stone, and though I find here no permanent dwelling, I know he'll give me a mansion my own. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never go.
Think me poor, deserted or lonely. I'm not discouraged, I'm heaven bound. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a harp and crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never go. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold. And someday yonder
will never more wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold.
You may be seated. that I wanted people to speak to. So here's what I did. I want you, if you are a freshman, now if you're in my class, you already have this outline, and I'm going to say a few things that you haven't heard. Besides that, that is this. Jesus has made us alive. If you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, Jesus has made you alive. The moment that you take your faith in Him, put your trust in Jesus Christ, He gave you life. Now when Jesus made that statement in John chapter 10, I come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. You realize the ground you're walking through? He wasn't talking to a bunch of students at Arlington Baptist University. He was talking to a bunch of people that knew nothing but slavery. They were under Roman rule completely. They had no rights. They had no privileges. Jesus stepped on the scene, and at 30 years of age, He makes this statement, I have come that you might have life and have it abundantly. And how do you get an abundant life if you don't have any rights whatsoever? He wasn't talking about the circumstances. I'm talking about a relationship, and that's what I want you to see this morning. The joy of having a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm coming to my life, and I want you to have it abundantly. If you have notes that you can write on, and some of you have your phones already open, and I'm sure you're as quick as you did right here, just go to a part that you can make a list. It says A-L-I-D-E-A. A. I wonder what an abundant life looked like, and I started asking the Lord, Lord, show me. I want that more than anything in the world, because I want to be a teacher to you. We saw so many of our Olympians this past, in fact, the Olympics, we did exactly that. Wasn't it a thrill? I loved it whenever we saw those who would participate in sports, and they did well, and they always would give glory to Jesus Christ. I love sending the ball. Every time she had the opportunity, here's what she said about Bill Dillon as a healer. She said world record, in fact, he set three or four of them already, just that one of the Olympics again this year in the hurdles, 400 hurdles, ran faster than any woman has ever run the 400-meter hurdles. Here's what she said. She said, in the success that God has granted me, He has given me a platform. I want every word of my mouth to be in praise. And I love that she said this, not just God. She can almost be generic sometimes, but she says, but the Lord Jesus. I stop right there for just a moment and say this to you. Who is it whether you think of Him? Who is it when you go out to the court that you think of us? A lot of those athletes are all about them. There were some 40 athletes that I've become familiar with that were in the Olympic Games this year. And every time they were interviewed, they gave glory to Jesus Christ. And they were doing what they're doing, that Jesus Christ might be on. Why are you playing basketball? What are you doing? Why are you playing basketball? What are you doing at volleyball games? What about you? Because what we find is you have your reward. It's all about you. And okay, that's all there is. And Cindy said, I have a platform to minister to this Jesus Christ that is in the Olympics so that people can have this. I hope that you grow as a person. I hope that your soul is a happiness. I hope it's about you. Lord, it's about you. I haven't always been successful with what I told you when I made John 10:10 my life worthy. God knows my heart has been my goal. It's been my desire. Lord, I want to receive you in my gift of life. So I say this, the aim is this. And here's the difference of a system that I found, as I look at the Word of God, that just says this will give you an overflow of life. Do you understand that? Who do I have in life? Here's the next. Always make every day a good day. Always make every day a good day.
How many of you are morning people? You wake up in the morning, you're happy, you're excited, you're thrilled. Believe it or not. How many of you, those kind of people really make you mad? Yeah. The Bible says this is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I wake up happy. My wife gets up before I do. I wake up happy. And I sing all the time. I don't always sing on the key. I don't always know the words. I just make them up as I go along. But the Lord's given me a song, and I hope He's given you a song. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Said I, boy, that's over the years. The psalmist, whenever he wrote that, he was not looking around at the circumstances. Sometimes our circumstances, let's face it, sometimes our circumstances speak, don't they? My 8 o'clock plan. I have to get up with him. Look at that, he's here this morning. And he offered me 4 hours to do my 8 o'clock plan. So every Tuesday, I was calling you. It's time to get your rear out of bed. Anybody want to hear that? There he is. There he is right there. We made it through, didn't we, brother? Absolutely. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Not dependent upon the circumstances. This is determined. It's built on your determination of when you're looking at that day. Lord, this is another day of life you've given me. Let me tell you something, gang. When you get to be 71, you start thanking the Lord for every day. Every day. You don't have anything else you got left. But at your age, start now. Begin now. Lord, it's not about the circumstances. It's about you. This is the day you've given me. Another wine to be alive, to live for you, to experience the joy that you have for me this week, and or today, and this day. And the Lord help me to be kind about it. You've given me another day. Hallelujah. Amen. Always make the day a good day. Here's another one. Live your life enthusiastically. Live your life enthusiastically. I get carried away with the first class, would y'all agree with me? Dr. Evans sometimes gets carried away whenever he's speaking in class. I was super early boy class, I was teaching, and all of a sudden, I mean, they just bumped me out of laughter over here, and I thought, well, what is all sitting there funny? So I went over there to examine it. And I said, what did I say, or what did you do? She said, she looked at me, and she said, you just get to do it. And it's funny. Well, when we've got something to talk about in society, we ought to be excited about it. You and I do. Live your life enthusiastically. I want to tell you something. Ever since I was 14 years old, I think about getting problems on Savior. I haven't gone over it yet. I'm a child of the truth. I'm going to heaven. I've got a mansion. Tell someone with you with a hot love. That's what I'm going to do. I'm a child of the truth. With Jesus Christ, we have so much to be excited about. Catch that. Don't let the circumstances destroy that spirit. Live life enthusiastically. Here's another one. I need to isolate the negative. I don't know if you've come across any of them, but do you? I'm sure there are a few. I've only met a few in the 21 years I was here, but there are some, and they sometimes just stick out like a sore thumb. I give you the Bible tells us that no evil communication proceed out of your mouth, but that was as good as you of edifying. Some people just see things the wrong way. There's not anything good. You met people like that, haven't you? Now, I hope I'm not thinking somebody that's that way, but if I am, let me help you this morning. You know, there's some people that it's everything's sick. I mean, everything is just wrong. Dorm life, it's dorm life sick. Cafeteria food's nasty. The classes are boring. got to be careful with hanging around people like that. Because listen to me, they'll start affecting you if you're not careful. And we all do everything we can to try to lift them out of that cloud. But don't make them your best friend. Don't make them your confidant. Don't make them the one that you go to whenever you need advice, the one that you hang around all the time. In fact, I treat them like a leper. I get as far away from them as I could and just try to encourage them from a distance. Because they'll drag you down. So what I say to you and to myself again is we have to isolate the negative in our lives. This world is negative, isn't it? And so you and I need to realize that we have to compartmentalize. Are you listening? Isolate the negative in your life. Now here's another one. We have always made the day a good day. If you like that one and you believe that it works, say amen. Okay, if you live life enthusiastically, how many of you think we ought to live life enthusiastically if we know Jesus Christ? Say amen. Or somebody say amen. So, need to live life enthusiastically. Say amen. I need to isolate the negative. There's some people who will drag me down. Don't let them drag you down. Here's the next one. Z. Validate people in your life. Validate the people in your life. Ephesians 4 again says, edify one another. You don't know the word edify means to be built up. Did you know you can find one place in the Bible that talks about us being destroyers or tearing people down? You can't find one verse about it. And some Christians, I think that's their life call. But it's not. We are constantly called on to be builders, to be edified, to be encouraged. Boy, that's important in every aspect of our life. It's especially important, athletes, it's especially important in athletics. Who's going to coach? Because our attitude is catchy. See, I'm like the negative. If you've got one negative person on the team or looking at a game in a negative way, it affects everything that happens. But if you've got those that are constantly encouraging, that's what I mean by validate one another. When you see a teammate that's starting to get down, when you see someone in your life who's starting to get a little bit out of sorts, go to them and help them. Let them know. Be an encourager. You did not get to where you are, the success that you've done to this point, by yourself. First and foremost, it took the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. Whether you're saved or you're not saved right now, let me say this to you. You're not here by accident. And I'll bet you that the president has already told you that. You're here because God wanted you here. Well, you need to at least be honest enough to say, I want to find out why God brought me on to that situation. Be an encourager around other people. Somebody helped you. Somebody was an encouragement to you. Well, when they are, and let me say this thing, validate people in your life. Hey, the people that have meant something in your life, help them. Let them know. It may be a parent, it may be a coach, it may be a pastor, it may be a professor. But let them know. Help them. Validate people in your life. We're to be builders, gang of one another. All of us have been on teams at some time or another where it just took a couple of them that had that negativism, and it affected the whole season. It affected every game. It affected everything was transpiring within that team. But when you've got a team full of folks that are validating people in your life, when you've got a church full of people that we do, and I thank the Lord for the folks that came from 97th Baptist Church family. When you've got a group of folks that are constantly pulling for you, they want to see you succeed. They want to help you succeed. They're constantly telling you what you need in their life. Listen, validate one another. It makes such a difference. Hey, those of you that are in athletics, let me ask you a question. Attitude is important. probate case that ever came to the court for you. I was blessed and took the court of second room. I sat in all night, and I tried to attend every court meeting that I did, but I said, I came down one morning, and this is when Dr. McDaniel was the basketball coach, ladies and girls basketball coach. Did anybody come back today from Goldberg? What did you see? What did you see? Yeah, some brother. Yeah. I came down and they were practicing, and the practice was going down. So I'm sitting there watching it, and I can see the steam starting to roll off of my president. And it finally stopped. And then the smoke began. And he said, "Stop it! Stop it then! You're the number one steam in all of the United States of America. Start acting like it." And you know what? The whole practice changed. Our attitude is so very important. How we approach those things. Valuing the people in your life. Lift them up. Edify people in your life. There's some of you that after this is over, you probably ought to go back to your dorm room, get on your phone, and call your grandma or grandpa, or call your mom or your dad, or call that coach, or call that special teacher that you may have had and just say, "Hey, I never told you this, or I haven't told you this in a long time, but I want you to know I appreciate so much the part you played in my life and me being where I am today." Not only should we do that, but we ought to validate one another, okay? Encourage one another. Don't get down on one another. I was always at a loss when I was at baseball games, and I always sat there right where I could see them when they were just going back, and one of our guys just rocked out. And I was always, you know, I thought, what did you do? What is that? When they're walking back to the study, just nothing. Oh, how about it? Nothing. We wanted to say, "Way to go! Hey, you showed up this time, okay. Way to go, buddy." Yeah. It was her fault that you did it, yeah? Uh-huh. What do you think? Well, usually you have to say something encouraging, right? Hey, thank you. See you next time. Of course, when they struck out for 3 times in a row, then it got closed. That's when I don't say anything. Validating. Does it make sense to you? Well, validating people. Are you encouraging? If I were to take all of your classmates aside, if I were to take your class aside, if I were to take one of the particular sports aside, and ask them about you, and I said, "Is he an encourager? Is he an encourager?" What would they say? Because I'm going to tell you something, you're not really experiencing what I have come to know is an abundant life in Jesus Christ. When you learn to value the people in your life, to live with the people in your life, and you don't have a father, always make the real person. That's your relationship. Live like enthusiastic. We've got a lot to live inside of that. You may not realize it, you have a whole lot to be excited about in your heart. And all the things that you do in the relationship. Live life enthusiastically. I believe in it. Validate the people in your life. Then the last thing is this. I need to expect good things. I need to expect for God to show up. How many times, I dare say that many of you have actually used that verse, and we hear a lot of athletes, whenever they're interviewed, use that verse that says what? I can. Come on, help me. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. Do you realize that any successes that I have over some of that feeling, whether it's in the field of education that you intend to enter into, or whether it's being a mother or a daddy, or whether it's being a good son or a good daughter, it all I need to expect good things. I need to expect that God is going to show up. I can do all things through Christ with strengthens me. Listen to this, but in Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, and this became a part of my life, and I want it to become a part of yours. It says this, let us not be weary in well doing. You ever get tired of doing right? Apparently, God knew that we did, and we would have put it in the book, but he said, let us not be weary. Here it is. In due season, we will reap if we may not. Keep all seasons apart. We need to expect good things. We need to expect God is going to work in our lives. Galatians chapter 6, where that verse is, he said, what you sow, you're going to reap. You sow the wrong thing. I want you, and I hope you understand the fear which I'm going to be in. I want you to have the joy of your life. And I have the joy of your life. I want your walk with you to be sweeter than what I have. I can stand before you and tell you this. Tomorrow is the last day I have on planet Earth. I'll leave you to go to heaven and I'll let you know when you're about to go to heaven. I've got you. Always make the day a good day. This is the day before the day. Live our life as good as you can. Isolate the devil. Let people feel bad. I some people can see the devil. But I've driven them from a little bit. This particular illustration just came into my mind. And you know, negative people will blame everybody else. I've never heard a negative person own up to, well, you know, I'm just having a horrible, bad, awful day, and I have a terrible attitude, and I own up to it. No, they always just want to blame somebody else, don't they? It's the teacher's fault, the professor's fault. It's the coach's fault, well, I'm having such a bad, awful, good turn out today. I heard about these boys, they probably could have been in the guy's court. And they were a little bit mischievous, but definitely they were God's work. And they got this idea that they're going to play a prank on their dad. And their dad had a mustache, and so they took that while he was asleep. They went in there while he was sleeping, and they put Limburger cheese. Anybody ever smell Limburger cheese? Nothing to smell in the word. They were just what they did. They cured all of their mustache. He woke up in the morning. He said, this room is amazing. He got up, went in the restroom, he combed his hair, get ready for the next, put on his clothes. He said, this bathroom. Even then, he got out of the bathroom, the bedroom, went downstairs to the kitchen, he walked down there into the kitchen, as he walked in the kitchen, he said, good Lord, he said, this kitchen stinks. I'm going to work. He
got out there, got in his car, he's driving to work, where he works, and he said, are you kidding me? He said, this car stinks. Got to where he worked, parked in his space, got out on the parking lot, and he's walking in towards the building where he goes to work, and he said, oh my God, he said, the whole world stinks. Are you ready for it? The problem is right underneath. Did you get it? Freshman, let me talk to you. Did y'all get that? Oh, okay, good. See, the problem's not all these other things. Just like that dad, the problem is mine. Isn't it? Be careful about that. Be careful to isolate the negative in your life. Download the people in your life. I hope we do that today. I hope we start doing that. In fact, can I encourage you to give you a homework assignment? Find someone every day that you can get encouragement from. Find somebody today that you can go to and say, hey man, I haven't ever told you this in a long time. In fact, I would start with you, Ryan. She has been in every school. She has been in every class that I have taught her. She's made A's in every one of them. If I ever gave her anything less than 100, she wouldn't know why. But I would say something. She was a joy to have in class. She was a joy to have in class because she was always there. She was always excited about what was going on. She always took great notes. She stayed in school with lots of classes. She was a blessing in the world. She got a little bit of it. I think I did. But you see what I'm saying is, not somebody still running. But this bad person, actually, you are the last one. You're the last one. Somebody to do it. Now listen, I'm not talking about these two. I'm talking about these two. And let them go. They helped me. They were encouraging. They were blessing. Didn't it feel good when somebody said that to you? Didn't you feel good when I said that? Good. I never let you go to that. Validate the people you like and you expect God. Make sense with God to everything. God has just an amazing thing in your life. And you know what? All the successes in the some of the testimonies that I was watching about, I think some 20, 40 outlays that I was looking at. They're all giving glory to Jesus Christ and what Jesus Christ has done and what he did in their life and their success. They owed it all to him. Sydney McLaughlin said, every time I start to run a race, I expect to lose. But then she said something, and I thought it was crazy. She said, I expect to lose. But I determined a long time ago that whether I was or I didn't was, God will do some amazing things. He's going to do some amazing things in your life. This is right. He wants to do it. He wants to do it. So good. I realize that Tom did the first semester of the new year, but he's come with a lot of different backgrounds. Some of you may have come in here, and you really don't have a personal relationship with Jesus. Jesus Christ loves you. Not the world. But God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son that whosoever believes in him. And God brought it right into the world. That whosoever believes in him will not perish.
you have never just opened your heart. Say, Jesus, I know who you are. I believe that you love me. I believe that you died on the cross for all of my sins. You rose again. Jesus, right now, I pray for my sins and my way of doing things. Jesus, I pray for you. And I want you to be my friend. From the day of the day, I will pray for you. You bow your head to the rest of the world. Is that where you are? Today, I will say yes. Today, I will begin to experience what Dr. Evans, you must do. And I want to know that I'm going to heaven no matter what. I will align to Jesus with the cross of Jesus. And today, I'd like to, right now, I'd like to just accept this into my heart. Today, I'd like to just say yes to Jesus Christ. That without me coming to you, without me embarrassing you in any way, factor forward, but I want to help you with that. If that's where you are right now, would you just look at me and where you are right now, holding your eyes, and you can run back and hear what you're doing. Basketball? Soccer? Baseball? Softball? What do you have to find out here today if you can run back there? Reach back to me. Today is my day. Today I say yes.
Thank you.
So I'm going to introduce you. This is David Evans. This is my son. And I got to admit, actually, we've got the great music, and I thought we were going to do it too. And I'm going to have two of them today, and focus on prayer. And glad to meet you. Thanks for your time.
Thank
you. Thank you.